Ever since the controversy started with Trisha Paytas claiming that she has dissociative identity disorder, I've heard a couple things. One of them is that Trisha Paytas is merely acting and pretending that she has dissociative identity disorder. And another thing I've heard is that there are actually brain studies around the diagnosis of DID. So I started to ask myself, what would actually happen if you compared the brains of Trisha Paytas and DissociaDID? What is up, everybody? This is Chris from the Rewired Soul, where we talk about the problem, but focus on the solution. And if you're new to my channel is all about mental health. And typically what I try to do is provide different tools and resources to help you improve your mental and emotional well-being, like I do for myself. I actually made a video yesterday about sleep habits to help with depression and anxiety. But today we're going to be researching dissociative identity disorder. Anyways, if you're into any of that stuff, make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell. All right, so those of you who aren't caught up to date, Trisha Paytas claimed that she had dissociative identity disorder. She actually self-diagnosed. Recently, Edwin from Edwin's Generation actually interviewed Trisha Paytas' ex-girlfriend who has dissociative identity disorder. I highly recommend that you check it out. They actually did a live stream as well. But anyways, Trisha Paytas linked a video claiming that DissociaDID was faking this and all that kind of stuff. But again, I was told that there are actually a lot of brain studies around this, and I am a big nerd. I am a big nerd when it comes to psychology, mental health, neuroscience, and all that stuff. So that's what I spent most of my morning doing, was looking into some of the research around dissociative identity disorder. And I actually found this very interesting one. But anyways, and we'll circle back to this at the end, but the only way to really like tell is if you put DissociaDID and Trisha Paytas in brain scans and saw what was actually going on. And we'll explain how this study went. But is that likely to happen? Not really, because you can't just walk in and say, yo, give me a brain scan. It takes a lot of money. But I mentioned this in another video, Logan Paul actually did that, and Logan Paul is rich. Now, although Trisha Paytas isn't making Logan Paul money, Trisha Paytas does have some extra money laying around. So if Trisha Paytas wanted to, she could actually go and try to recreate this study, all right? But anyways, let's jump into this study. So the first thing is, the study comes from 2012, and yeah, it started out by talking about a little bit of the controversy around dissociative identity disorder. So it says, dissociative identity disorder is a disputed psychiatric disorder. Research findings and clinical observations suggest that DID involves an authentic mental disorder related to factors such as traumatization and disrupted attachment. A compelling view indicates that DID is due to fantasy proneness, suggestibility, suggestion, and role-playing. Here we examine whether dissociative identity state-dependent psychobiological features in DID can be induced in high or low fantasy-prone individuals by instructed and motivated role-playing and suggestion. So basically what they're saying is there is some controversy around the diagnosis, saying that people who show symptoms of DID, they are, you know, easily able to act, such as what people are saying about Trisha Paytas. Trisha Paytas is also an actress, all right? But yeah, they say that their suggestibility and acting might play a role. So they wanted to test that theory out by doing some brain scans. So basically what they did was they got three groups of people. They got a group of people with dissociative identity disorder. They got people who are high fantasy prone, and they got people who are low fantasy prone. So you have people with the actual disorder, people who would be into like LARPing, like live action role playing, or an actor or actress. And then they got eight people who are just like, meh. So basically the way you could think about it is they got 11 people like DissociaDID, 10 people like Trisha Paytas, and eight people like me. I'm not an actor, I'm not into fantasy role playing or anything like that. And they compared all of these different groups in this study. So another one of the debates that they brought up was, despite its inclusion in the Diagnostic Statistical Manual for Mental Disorders, the DSM-5, the genuineness of dissociative identity disorder continues to be disputed. Supporters of the diametrically opposed trauma-related and non-trauma-related views have been engaged since decades in a passionate debate regarding its validity as a mental disorder, and whether it is related to traumatization or to fantasy proneness, suggestibility, suggestion, and simulation. So what they wanted to do was measure the cerebral blood flow, like the blood that's going through your brain. They wanted to measure that in people with dissociative identity disorder compared to the brain states of people who are fantasy prone, all right? So for the groups who were high and low in fantasy proneness, they told them to act as if the you I've been addressing thus far is one of those people, and as if the you I've been talking to is unaware of the other co-inhabitants. When I provide a signal for contacting another co-inhabitant, act as though you are another person. So basically, they had people with dissociative identity disorder, when they were switching different identity states, they monitored that, but then on the other hand, for the people in the groups for high and low fantasy proneness, they told them to act as if, you know, hey, this is you, okay? But when we cue you, and what they did was they did some memory stimulation and they involved like trauma-related memories and everything like that. And they said like, act as if you are two different people. The other person that you're switching to is a completely different person who is unaware of this conversation, all right? So part of this, what they found was when they did this, there was like little to no hippocampal response. So the hippocampus in the brain is responsible for memories, okay? So those with dissociative identity disorder had a low hippocampal response, which means when switching to those states, it wasn't pulling the memories in the same way that it was for people with high and low fantasy proneness. So basically, people with high and low fantasy proneness, when they would switch, you could see from the brain scan that it was pulling memories, right? Because that is something that is automatic, right? So if you say, hey, pretend like this other state was never in that conversation, like you can't really fake that. You see what I mean? When you are told, okay, now we're gonna talk to this other person, your brain is automatically pulling these memories. But those with dissociative identity disorder, that wasn't happening. The hippocampal reaction or response wasn't as high as it was for those who were faking, all right, who were acting. So what did they find? So they found some differences between how the brain works for those with dissociative identity disorder and those who were high and low fantasy prone. What was interesting, here's what I found really, really interesting about this, was people who were high in fantasy proneness actually had brains less similar to those with low fantasy proneness when compared to those with dissociative identity disorder, all right? So you take somebody like Trisha Paytas who acts and everything like that, you take somebody like me who isn't into fantasy or role playing or acting or anything like that, my brain would actually be closer to somebody with dissociative identity disorder when going through those states and this research and this experiment. So these researchers also argue against the socio-cognitive view of dissociative identity disorder, believing that it is based on societal or cultural factors, right? One of the arguments is that, you know, people just do, you know, switch caught on camera or like meet my alters videos, you know, because it's like a thing, right? It's a thing on YouTube. But what they're saying is that this isn't really an influencer. This doesn't help people better imitate the brains of people with dissociative identity disorder. And basically the final findings, the final conclusion of all this says this. The findings are at odds with the idea that differences among the different types of dissociative identity states in DID can be explained by high fantasy proneness, motivated role enactment, and suggestion. They indicate that DID does not have a sociocultural origin. So again, this is one of many studies. They've done a bunch of studies on this. I was looking through, I just found this one kind of interesting because they compared it to like somebody who like is regularly acting and playing out a role. But there are a bunch of other ones. If you like this video, just let me know down in the comments. I am somebody who is not well-versed in dissociative identity disorder, although I have worked with many, many people with different psychological disorders. Haven't worked with anybody who had dissociative identity disorder. And I like learning. I like educating myself about different mental health disorders. It helps me be a little bit more empathetic, you know? Like a lot of us just focus on our illness, right? I focus on my anxiety, my depression, my addiction. These are the things that I care about, right? Like a lot of us care about our thing. So what I try to do, I try to educate myself on other disorders just so I can have a better understanding of what other people are going through. Because when it comes to mental health awareness and, you know, the stigma around mental health, like, it's all of us. Like, we're all in this together, right? So the best thing we can do is learn about this, especially if we come into contact with somebody with this disorder. Understanding a little bit more can help us be there for them, all right? But anyways, to conclude this video, like I said, the only way to really prove what's really going on is to take Trisha Paytas and put her in an fMRI brain scan and run her through an experiment like this. But like I said, Trisha Paytas has a few extra dollars to throw around, maybe not do a music video here or there, probably enough money to do a brain scan, but hey, I'm just saying, all right? But anyways, that's all I got for this video. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you're new, make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell. And a huge, huge thank you to everybody who supports the channel over on Patreon, as well as everybody who supports the channel by buying my mental health books at therewiredsoul.com, and everybody who supports the channel by buying the Rewired Soul merch from the merch store. You're all awesome. Thanks again for watching. I'll see you next time.